A tough final 3 minutes against the Cincinnati Bearcats sent the victory bell back to Cincinnati once again. This weekend, the Redhawks will open up Mid-American Conference play on the road against the Central Michigan Chippewas. Head coach Chuck Martin joins me to talk about both games next on Redhawk Football Weekly. This is Redhawk Football Weekly. Brought to you by G&J Pepsi-Cola of Hamilton, refreshing southwestern Ohio since 1939. By Koenig Equipment, found online at koenigequipment.com. By Marathon, fueling the American spirit. By Bud Light, reminding you to enjoy responsibly among friends. Steve Baker talks with Miami head football coach Chuck Martin after this on Redhawk Football Weekly.
The new celebration rules are in place and Pepsi is all for it. So what's big man Joe Staley doing? He's celebrating a touchdown. He didn't score. The sad truth is the odds of a guy like Joe scoring a real touchdown are the same as zero. But it's fun to dream, isn't it? Even if those dreams are delusional. Hey, there's no I in impossible, Joe. There is, there's two. Shh.
Ever wonder what's in a beer? If it's a Bud Light, it's four essential ingredients: barley, rice, water, and hops. Here's to the beer you can always count on, brewed to be America's favorite light lager.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome into Red Hawk Football Weekly. I'm Steve Baker, the voice of the Red Hawks. Chuck Martin will join me in just a moment. The Red Hawks, a tough loss on Saturday night at Yeager Stadium, 21-17 in the battle for the victory bell against the University of Cincinnati Bearcats. They'll be on the road this Saturday, opening up Mid-American Conference play at Kelly Short Stadium in Mount Pleasant, Michigan, as they'll face the Chippewas of Central Michigan University. Head coach Chuck Martin joins me now. And coach, a tough ball game. The team played well enough to win that ball game, was ahead going into the final 3 minutes, and then things kind of fell apart.
Yeah, excruciating for us. It's anytime you lose a football game, it's tough. Anytime you lose a football game when you have a 17-6 lead, with 4 minutes to go, it's 10 times as tough. You add in the fact that it's UC and battle for the victory bell. You add it into how passionate our fan base is about beating UC and having the opportunity and really having it in our grasp and to let it go. It just magnifies how we feel and how disappointed we are. And you can say, well, it's just another game. It's not just another game, right. It's UC. And that means a lot to us. It means a lot to Miami. And over my 4 years here, I know how important that game is to everybody involved in Miami and how badly they enjoy beating UC. So it just adds to our disappointment and how we feel in our stomachs that we felt like we let everybody down.
The atmosphere was incredible at Yeager Stadium, and I know that's something we've been looking for, and it doesn't get much better than it was on Saturday night.
Yeah, no, the whole day was fantastic up until about 11 o'clock. The whole campus was buzzing all week, and it was all day Saturday, and the tailgate started early, and we had an incredible crowd, by far the best crowd since we've been here during our time. Kids were really, really well prepared. Coaches did a great job. Both sides of the ball. The game went exactly how we kind of hoped it would go. Close, low scoring. We knew Cincinnati was very strong on defense. We felt good about our defensive matchup. We wanted to play for a lead. For 56 minutes, we did everything according to practice, according to plan. The kids played their tails off. We were shorthanded, obviously, without our starting tailback and out starting W. Then, you know, we lose a bunch of players during the game. And it should be this incredible story how we got the bell back and we beat UC and we overcome crazy adversity with all the injuries that we went through during the game. But we didn't get the job done in the last 4 minutes, and that's not the story, and it's very disappointing.
Let's take a look at the first half highlights. We'll start with UC's offense. Miami got the ball but couldn't move to get it there in the second half, and now we'll talk about UC and their first drive. They drive, but Miami's defense clamps down.
Yeah, great anticipation by Tony Reed. Got a chance for an interception there. Gets a nice pass breakup. In zone coverage, they thought they had to see him in the zone, but Tony does a good job reading the quarterback's eyes, as you see right here, and breaking on the football and making a nice play for us.
Very next play, again, the defense strikes and gets to the quarterback, Hayden Moore.
Good coverage behind, allowed time for our pass rush to get there. You'll see Kanan come off the edge and get the sack.
They had to settle for a field goal. Josh Pasley boots it through from 41. Then the Miami offense comes to play, and a big hitter down the middle for Maurice Thomas.
Yeah, good play action off our jet series. Great protection. Maurice runs by him. Great throw by Gus. Big strike gets us down into UC territory.
Yeah, you start in at the 15 of Miami, and you go directly to the 30-yard line of the Bearcats. You see it here, and Gus bought a little time drifting right and found a wide-open Maurice Thomas for a big play, and you'll get one more look at it here as Maurice looks it all the way in, and again, a big play to the 30. The very next play would have the tight end, Ryan Smith, with a big catch.
Again, another good little off-our-swing pass, little play fake off-our-swing pass, and hits Smitty down the middle. Shows like he's going to block, gets in the seam, makes a nice catch, takes a nice hit, delivers a nice hit, and we're in business in the red zone now.
It was second and 10, but a holding penalty makes it second and 20, and you go back to Luke Mayock and get a big score.
Yeah, Luke had a huge game, should be a big part of a great celebration story. James Gardner out, everybody concerned, and Luke Mayock steps in James' replacement and does a lot of the things that James Gardner does for us.
And again, you see the catch. Nice adjustment to the football, getting inside position and hauling in the touchdown. Miami leads it 7-3 at this point, and that would be the way the first quarter would end. And then the defenses take over. You see the final 2.5 minutes of the first quarter, and Heath Harding reads it beautifully.
Yeah, great. They try to do a little swing pass. Heath reads it. They try to get the tackle out to block him. Heath beats the block, gets vertical, really solid tackle, and hits them for a negative play.
Next drive for the Bearcats, first turnover of the ball game. Actually, excuse me, that's Doug Costin getting to the quarterback and again forcing a punt there as he puts the pressure on the quarterback. He had a pretty good game too.
Yeah, and better pass rush in week three. We didn't have much pass rush week one and week two. We got better and better. Here you'll see again.
This is the pick.
Koenig on a little pressure there. Good anticipation. Josh Allen deflects the ball. DeAndre Montgomery tracks it, picks it off. Huge play for our defense.
See the interception there one more time. Great job by Josh Allen. DeAndre Montgomery with the interception, and we would go to the first half break. As you see it there, 7-3 was the score at halftime for the Miami Redhawks. We will come back and talk second half and more with head coach Chuck Martin in a moment here on Redhawk Football Weekly.
You train, it twinges. You twist, it tears. For every way you move and every way it hurts, the orthopedics and sports medicine team at Mercy Health provides comprehensive expert care for bones, muscles, tendons, and joints. With more than 60 physicians and specialists and more therapists, athletic trainers, and conveniently located sports medicine facilities than any other system in Greater Cincinnati, Mercy Health helps you stay in motion. Call 844-9-GO-PLAY for same day or next business day appointments.
It's true, fans are craving Dr. Pepper more than ever. So I've assembled a team. They're not exactly five-star, but they've got spirit. We'll be at tailgate, the cheap seats, love seats. If you're craving Dr. Pepper, we'll be there.
We'll be everywhere!
Me up there.
And yes, we are taking walk-ons.
I'm in.
Doug Flutie?
Flutie's in! Ice cold, Dr. Pepper, hip!
Here's the boys' medium.
That'll work.
This segment of Red Hawk Football Weekly is brought to you by Courtyard Marriott Hamilton, conveniently located just miles from Miami University. Welcome back into Red Hawk Football Weekly. Steve Baker here. The Red Hawks on the road this Saturday. They'll open up MAC play at Central Michigan. Head coach Chuck Martin rejoins me at the break, 7-3. I know you were anxious to get to the locker room there at halftime, but you had to be happy with your team up 7-3.
Yeah, no, we were ecstatic. We felt like that's exactly how the game was going to go. We had a lead. Defense was playing strong like we knew they would. Offense was taking care of the football. We were playing field position. Our special teams, which we thought was going to be a key, was playing really well in the first half. We want to keep forcing Cincinnati on long fields, take advantage of our opportunities. We really talk about, hey, let's get the lead to two scores and put them in a really big hole.
And you were able to do that in the second half. You talked to the team, and again, there were some injuries in this ball game. Do you talk to them about how physical it is and you know, what is happening on the field?
No, they know it's a normal football game. Yeah. And we had, you know, we lost some guys during the game. We lost some guys the week before that didn't even dress, that couldn't play for us. So it's just part of it. But we have kids. We have better depth, and kids stepped up, and Sam Conley finally stepped up in the second half and played. And we talked about Luke Maik stepping up, and Cedric Estay steps up for DeAndre Daniels, who's out with an injury. And again, there's so many positives of things that happened Saturday. Obviously, it's hard to focus on them after a tough defeat, but those kids did step up and play very well.
UC takes the opening kick, and they march down a little bit, but you know, they get to the 35-yard line. We're going to go to the highlights here in a moment, but deciding to go for it, fourth and inches inside their own territory. Sometimes a tough call to make there, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it's always, fourth down's always a tough call, and you're always a genius when it works. And
oh,
you're
yeah.
You're always not a genius, you know. If you don't go for it on fourth down, you're not aggressive. If you do go for it and you don't get it, then it's a bad call. So, obviously, it was fourth and a foot, and they felt like they could get it on a sneak.
As we take a look at the highlights, we'll see that play here to begin the second half of our highlights. And, again, right at the 35-yard line, they need about 6 inches, but this is a great play by your defense.
Yes, the defensive line, just unbelievable job, and linebackers and even the secondaries in on the tackle. So all they needed was a couple inches. They got no push. We pushed them back, as you can see, stuff, forced the quarterback wide, and then you see our guys grab a hold of them and don't let them go anywhere, and obviously they didn't get any yards on the play at all. It was a pretty easy call.
Actually got a push in the back of the quarterback there, and Heath Harding pulling the other way to make sure he doesn't get there. Miami takes over, and this is the Kenny Young drive, I'll call it. Starts out with a pass to Kenny.
Yeah, good job. Good read by Gus. Look downfield, nothing there. Swung the ball out to Kenny, got a 6, 7, 8 yards on first down.
Takes it down inside the 30-yard line there. First and 10 later from the 12 after a Gus Ragland run, and here's the handoff to Kenny Young off left side.
Yeah, does a nice job up front, gets him some air, breaks the tackle, and pushes the ball down the 5-yard line. Kenny really played tremendously the whole night for us.
Yeah, it's first and goal after this play, and again, hard running there by Kenny Young. Puts it inside the 5, and he finishes the drive here.
Yeah, good job up front. Seal the inside. We get a little kickout block. Grant Nemec leading the way. Gets a nice cut block on the Will linebacker. Gets Kenny pretty easy score.
Again, one more look at it there as he goes off the left side, and a big hole there to get into the end zone. Extra point makes it 14-3, and for the next two drives, Cincinnati comes up empty. Here, Josh Posley misses a 47-yard field goal wide right as the Red Hawk defense forces the Bearcats into a field goal. And then third and goal, it's Cedric Assay.
Yeah, great job by the secondary. Josh Allen, we got a coverage back there, and Josh Allen has some flexibility to make some calls based on what he sees, and he put us in the right look, and then Cedric Assay reads the route and comes up with a big pick and comes up with a really nice interception and creates some really good field position for our offense.
Great job by Cedric Assay. He ran about 120 yards to get a 46-yard return, but you'll see it again here and read beautifully. As a little miscommunication, I think, there with the receivers, he continued his route. But Cedric runs it all the way back across the field, gets a couple of blocks and able to bring it out to the 46-yard line. The Red Hawks, after the interception, wouldn't be able to move the ball, but they punt the ball away, and the Bearcats would capitalize as they go to the fourth quarter here early in the fourth, kick a field goal, that one 36 yarders, but the Red Hawks respond as they move the ball down the field with Gus Ragland again to Luke Maik, 22 yards.
Another huge play by Gus, another huge play by Luke. Third down, get it protected, get the ball one-on-one outside. Maik makes a nice jump and catch, letting Luke, who's 6'4", 6'5", use his height against a shorter DB, let him go up and get the football.
Third and 7 here, and a scary play for a moment for Gus Ragland as he's going to wind up running with the football. Did not initially get the first down, but you see the hit there by Perry Young. It would be reviewed. The flag and the call on the field was targeting. It would be reviewed, and indeed, it was targeting against Perry Young, and you get the field goal after the penalty.
Yep. Nice drive by the offense, 14-6. Good answer. We used a ton of clock. Take it from about the 9-minute mark down to about the 4:40-minute mark. Then this is obviously the portion of the game that unraveled. Blew a coverage there. We blew a blitz earlier to let him get down there. They got a 40-some yard gain on our bread and butter blitz for us, and then blew a coverage there.
Third and 7 here, and the unthinkable, the pick 6 to give the Bearcats the lead.
Yeah, just tough decision. Gus didn't see the coverage right, thought he had Kenny open. Obviously, he did not have Kenny open, and it cost us dearly.
You still have time, though, with 1:02 to go. Again, Maik plays a key role, 23-yarder there, followed by a 23-yarder to Sam Martin.
Yeah, really good job in our 2-minute offense. Really smart what we did with the ball, keeping the ball outside. Good job by Sam there, not just stepping out of bounds, but getting some extra yards before he steps out of bounds.
Your first and 10 at the 20 and throw to the end zone, and initially a pass interference call that was picked up by the officials. We saw that a lot on Saturday night, but you know, from that angle, clearly looks like pass interference, but they would pick up the flag and you would be down to 4th and 5, and unfortunately, we can't convert.
Yeah, disappointing ending, obviously. Good 2-minute drive, have a chance. Obviously, when you have Luke going up in the end zone, it looks like he's getting tackled and they throw the flag. Mm-hmm. You're going to have 4 downs inside the 10 to win the game. There's still plenty of time. There's still 20-some seconds left. Obviously, you're disappointed at that time that they decide mm-hmm. that what they thought they saw, they think that now they didn't see.
Right.
So just a tough situation, but you got to make a 4th down call. We didn't execute on 4th down and didn't get the job done.
It was a disastrous 2 minutes and 42 seconds, and a part of that was late in the ball game. We saw the 3rd and 7 play. It was 3rd and 2, but there was a delay of game penalty in there. And I'm going to give you a chance to talk about that in just a bit, but I do want to talk about the team after when they got out in the locker room. Obviously disappointed team. What'd you say to him?
Well, we always talk about finishing, mm-hmm. you know, and obviously we played our hearts out for 56 minutes and we didn't play well defensively the last drive. And we played uncharacteristic. We made mistakes, and mm-hmm. it'd be one thing if Cincinnati made a bunch of plays and drove down. They had a hard time moving the ball all day on us. We gave up a 40-yard play and a 20-yard play with just defensive mistakes. Then we have obviously a major kickoff return mistake where we could just take a knee in the end zone and we got the ball in the 25, and obviously you're probably sitting on a different outcome. But
yeah.
But we don't, and then obviously we have two major mistakes on offense. One, we don't get a timeout call, which I've said after the game, and I'm not going to get – we don't talk about, you know, you don't talk about officiating. The responsibility is on me to get the timeout call.
Mm-hmm.
Whether I thought I did what I should do or not, that doesn't matter. What I think, the mm-hmm. end of the day, it's my responsibility as head coach to get a timeout call, and the timeout was not called properly by me, and that cost us dearly, put us in a 3rd and 7. And obviously, you know, Gus just misread the coverage. They spun the man. He didn't see it. He thought it was one-on-one on the mm-hmm. wheel, and the guy was standing right there. He threw it right to him. So wasn't it just – he didn't see the coverage that they were in, and he made a mistake, obviously, at the wrong time. And you go through what we did on defense and the kickoff return and missing a timeout call and Gus misreading the coverage, and next thing you know, we're in a tough situation. And our kids, even then, we still bounce back and roll right back down the field, and I think we're going to win the game. When I see the ball going to Mayock in the corner of the end zone and Mayock's in position to go make a play, I think we're going to win the game.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, we end up not winning the game, and we have to deal with it. And the biggest thing is the finish, and the biggest thing is how do you react when things don't go your way? And this is we talked at the beginning of the show. This is a tough one for a lot of reasons. It's a tough mm-hmm. one because we put ourselves in position to win, and we did enough to good things to win. It's a tough one because a bunch of kids played in the game that weren't even supposed to play in the game and played really well, and they should be getting rewarded for it, but you're sitting in a locker room and you feel miserable, so it's hard to bring up the Luke Mayocks and the Sam Conleys and the – and there was tons of other kids. And then you got kids that feel bad because they didn't make plays down the stretch, you know. So we always say, like I say, accountable. Hey, I'm worried about what I didn't do down the stretch. I'm not worried about what you didn't do. I don't look past me, and we don't put blame on players. They played their tails off and deserved a better fate.
All right, Coach, thank you so much. We'll come back. The Central Michigan Chippewas are the next opponent for the Miami Redhawks. That'll be Saturday afternoon at Kelly Short Stadium. We'll talk about that when we return on Redhawk Football Weekly. Stay with us.
This segment of Redhawk Football Weekly has been brought to you by Courtyard by Marriott Hamilton, conveniently located just miles from Miami University.
There's people who care where I'm going, and good friends who welcome me home. So get a full tank of freedom, drive the American road, and with a full tank of freedom, find your own highway. We'll take you wherever you go, take you wherever you go.
Keep twisting, keep stretching, keep bending and chasing. For total and partial joint replacement to rehabilitation, the orthopedics and sports medicine team at Mercy Health provides comprehensive, expert care for bones, muscles, tendons, and joints. With more than 60 physicians and specialists, more therapists, and conveniently located facilities than any other system in Greater Cincinnati, Mercy Health helps you stay in motion. Find your specialist at mercymovesyou.com.
Welcome back. Our final segment of Red Hawk Football Weekly. Steve Baker joined by head coach Chuck Martin once again. And before we talk about the Chippewas, we talked about it's a physical football game on Saturday night. You had some guys beat up in that. How are you looking early in the week?
Yeah, it's hard to say early. Yeah. Obviously, we had no Gardner, no Zoe. They were game time decisions. They had not practiced all week, but we were hopeful to get them. They could not go game time. Obviously, we lost Junior. We're still waiting to hear there. We lost Maurice Thomas. We're still waiting to hear there. We got a bunch of MRIs scheduled as we speak. but they don't appear to be major, but what we have this week still yet to be determined. There's other guys that are battered and bruised. We lost a lot of guys during that game, hopefully just for the rest of that game, not for the long term.
Very good. The Chippewas this Saturday, 3:30 at Mount Pleasant, Michigan. Mid-American Conference opener. Early in the season, but the Chippewas are thinking they owe Miami one.
Yeah, and they had a really good team a year ago. Mm-hmm. They had a great start to their season. They didn't finish as well as they would have liked. They were, up there as a conference favorite. I know they feel the same way again this year. Mm-hmm. They're off to a good start. They've already beat a Power 5 team in Kansas. Mm-hmm. So they're 2-1 coming in. They lost to Syracuse, another Power 5 team last weekend. But they know they have a good football team. I don't know that they thought coming in last year we were as good as we were, and we ended up playing a very close game with them. We pulled away in the fourth quarter, but that was a very, very tight, close football game. So they'll be definitely looking to get off in the conference like we are and looking to pay us back a little bit from a year ago.
As obviously a different kind of look this year, I think, particularly defensively for the Chippewas.
Yeah, both sides. They got a new offense coordinator, so they've got a completely different offense. So anything we've done defensively in the past means nothing. They're whipping the ball. They threw the ball for 457 yards or something against Kansas. They got a five-star transfer quarterback from Michigan. The Morris kid was a highly touted kid out of high school. Then defensively, they've played more man this year than they did a year ago, but they've also played different style of offense. So it'll be interesting to see what they do against us.
Coach, wish you the best of luck on Saturday. And I know it's all about bouncing back and reacting and getting the team ready and just kind of putting this week behind them.
Yeah, no, we'll be ready to play next Saturday.
All right, thank you so much. Appreciate it. Again, 3:30 is the kick time for the Red Hawks at Central Michigan from Kelly Short Stadium. Myself, Terry Bridge, and Randy Hollowell will be there and have all of the action for you beginning at 2:30 with the Knowles of Oxford Tailgate Show. And you can get that on the Miami IMG Sports Network, also on MiamiRedHawks.com, and on your cell phone or computer with the TuneIn app. Again, 2:30 will be our air time as the Red Hawks take on the Chippewas. My thanks to Head Coach Chuck Martin, our crew here in Oxford as well. That'll do it for this week's Red Hawk Football Weekly. Thanks for watching.
This has been Red Hawk Football Weekly, brought to you by G&J Pepsi-Cola of Hamilton, refreshing southwestern Ohio since 1939, by Koenig Equipment, found online at koenigequipment.com, by Marathon, fueling the American spirit, by Bud Light, reminding you to enjoy responsibly among friends. Red Hawk Football Weekly is an exclusive production of the Miami IMG Sports Network.
You train, it twinges. You twist, it tears. For every way you move and every way it hurts, the orthopedics and sports medicine team at Mercy Health provides comprehensive expert care for bones, muscles, tendons, and joints. With more than 60 physicians and specialists and more therapists, athletic trainers, and conveniently located sports medicine facilities than any other system in Greater Cincinnati, Mercy Health helps you stay in motion. Call 844-9-GO-PLAY for same day or next business day appointments.
The new celebration rules are in place and Pepsi is all for it. So what's big man Joe Staley doing? He's celebrating a touchdown he didn't score. The sad truth is the odds of a guy like Joe scoring a real touchdown are the same as zero. But it's fun to dream, isn't it? Even if those dreams are delusional. Hey, there's no I in impossible, Joe. There is, there's two. Shh.